Recorded Books presents The Weirdo by Theodore Taylor, narrated by George Guidall.
Book 1. Samantha Sanders was 9 years old the afternoon she found Alvin Howell dead. She'd spotted the bright blue cloth over at the edge of Powhatan's swamp just as she turned into her yard. Odd, because it hadn't been there when she went to school in the morning. Putting her books down on the front porch, she crossed Chapinoak Road, jumped the ditch, and came upon the cloth quicker than she'd expected. It was half hidden in the brush. Raising a branch, she saw a man's face, mouth wide open as if he was trying to yell, eyes swollen with fright. On his chest was a splotch of red. Screaming, Sam stumbled back, falling down into the ditch water. Heart beating in her ears, she crawled out and ran for the house. Her hand shook as she lifted the hidden front door key off its nail and struggled to get it into the lock. Inside, she called the school district office, weeping now, trying to make herself understood. She wanted her mother, Del Sanders. Her papa, a Coast Guard bosun, was out on temporary sea duty. Her brother Steve was at baseball practice. Delilah Sanders came on.
Mama, 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 there's a dead man.
Where, Samantha?
Dead man.
Where, Samantha? Calm down, you're not making any sense.
Dead man, out in front of the house.
Are you sure?
He's there.
All right, listen to me. I'll call the sheriff. You lock the door and stay inside. Get some water. Take an aspirin. All right, Samantha.
Yes, Mama. Come home, please. Come home.
I'll be there just as fast as I can. Del arrived home 20 minutes later, even before the sheriff's car came up the road, roof light flashing, and went about holding Sam and calming her down. A moment later, there was a sharp knock on the door. A deputy in plain clothes, identifying himself as Ed Truesdale, showed his ID card and asked, "Where is he?" "My daughter said he's right across the road. Look for some blue just over the swamp ditch." Truesdale, taking a gun out of his coat, hurried off in that direction as Del and Sam watched silently. Sam clutched her mother. They saw him jump across the ditch, lift a branch, and stand there looking down. Then he returned to his car to use the radio. In a few minutes, he was up on the front porch again, asking if he could come in. Del said, "Sure. Would you like some coffee?" Truesdale said, "Yes, thank you. Could you tell me who found him?" "My daughter, Samantha. This is Samantha." Looking ill, Sam stood a few feet away. Truesdale said, "Miss Samantha, why don't you come over here and sit beside me and tell me what happened? I got a daughter a little bit older than you." He took a seat on the couch and motioned her over. Sam went over and sat down. "Where you go to school?"
"McFadden, in Currituck."
"Be darned, I put two daughters through there. What grade?"
"Fourth."
"Good grade. Well, I've got a few questions, Samantha. How'd you know he was there?"
"The dead man?"
Truesdale nodded. Sam told him she saw blue and went over to investigate.
"And you didn't see the blue there this morning when you went off to school?"
"No, sir."
"When you went up the road this morning, I'm guessing you take the bus." Sam nodded. "You see anybody? Any car pass you in either direction?"
"No, sir."
"You see anybody on foot?"
"No, sir."
"You ever seen the dead man before?"
"Yes, sir."
"Where?"
"At Dunnigan's."
That's what everyone called the nearby convenience store.
"You know his name?"
"No, sir."
"He is or was Alvin Howell. Lives, or did live, about 7 miles north off Tucker Road."
Truesdale scratched his head.
You ever see Mr. Howell come down Chapinoak before?"
"No, sir."
"Well, I guess that's about all, Samantha. And I do appreciate your help. Now, what you have to do is put this unfortunate incident out of your head forever. Hard to do, I know, but try, huh?
He smiled widely at her and stood. 7 years later, no one had found out who killed Mr. Howe. The incident had deepened Sam's dread of the swamp. Her papa had once said, "Only the Powhatan and the one who did it knows." He was probably right. p.m. The big Buick station wagon with Virginia plates made a rooster tail of ivory dust along the dirt road to the old white two-story farmhouse that sat on the northern edge on the Powhatan, west of the George Washington Canal. The Sanders farm was on the North Carolina side of the border, the hick side, as stuck-up Virginians often said, conveniently forgetting there wasn't much difference between rural Tar Heels and rural hayseed Virginians. Finally, the green wagon pulled into the front yard. Sam's Uncle Jack merrily tooted several times, causing her father's two penned hunting dogs to break the chill autumn silence. The din saw-toothed across the brown cornfields and over into the swamp. Sam opened the front door and yelled for old Martin, the blue-tick coonhound, and Rick, the black lab duck dog, to shut their loud mouths. They enjoyed making noise when visitors drove up. Then she hurried across the creaky porch and approached the new LeSabre, saying, "Hi, Uncle Jack, Aunt Peaches," looking in at the occupants. "Hi, Samantha, you pretty thing." He always said the same thing on seeing Sam. She knew different. If pretty was gauged by girls in fashion magazines or on the morning soaps, Sam wasn't pretty. In her own hard-eyed opinion, she was as plain as freckled biscuit dough. So she always cringed inwardly when Uncle Jack gave his silly compliment. Uncle Jack was promptly echoed by his wife, who said, "My, you do look delicious." Peaches was her legal christened name, Mrs. Peaches Sanders. Were fence posts delicious? Sam had never measured her buttocks, but figured they were no more than 16 inches cheek to cheek. Was being skinny and lanky, all legs, bony-shouldered, delicious? Maybe if she had the face to go with the reed body. Oh, if wishes were horses. Sticky sweet, but always good-hearted, Uncle Jack and Aunt Peaches were in their late 40s, well-to-do, unlike Sam's parents. Golf and bridge-playing folks. Jack Sanders had a successful insurance agency in Virginia Beach. "You two all ready to go?" Sam asked. "I am. Don't know about her." Jack glanced over at Peaches with raised eyebrows, grinning. Sam said enviously, "Just think, you two'll be in Paris in the morning." She wished, never mind the horses, she was going along. Even if they silly-talked all across the Atlantic. Going anywhere but up this miserable country road, going anywhere there were lights and people and things to do. Peaches said, "I've been thinking about this trip for 6 months, Samantha. I do declare I have packed and unpacked 10 times the last week." Then she laughed at herself. Uncle Jack, a porky, jowly man, unlike Sam's rail-thin father, added his own laughter. "Twice last night, twice!" In the rear seat, staring off at all the barking ruckus with yellow eyes, sat field champion Baron von Buckner, CDX, SDX, RDX. Otherwise known as Buck, he was Uncle Jack and Aunt Peaches's prize Weimaraner. The initials stood for Companion Dog Excellent, Obedience, Shooting Dog Excellent, Retrieving Dog Excellent. Buck had been winning ribbons and trophies since he was 7 months old. He'd been a national field trials champion 3 times in succession. Top 10 all-age gun dog. Sleek and strapping, smooth coat the color of the wintry sky, he was now available for breeding. Jack valued him at $50,000, but Sam still didn't believe that a dog, any dog, could be worth that much. Sliding out of the car, Jack went around to the tailgate, dropped it, and reached in to pull out 2 40-pound sacks of Science Diet, plus a shoebox of assorted vitamins. "Remember, 3 scoops a day in the evening. Peaches has packaged up the daily vitamin doses individually for you. Just toss them in with the food. Enough for the whole time here. I got him bathed this morning, and his special soap is in the shoebox. 2 weeks, do it again. Warm water, Samantha. Just dunk him in your tub." Sam nodded. They'd gone over it on the phone. Warm tub bath? Her father would tell Sam to use a hose on him. Uncle Jack was paying $50 a week to have Sam mind Buck for the 6 weeks. Said he didn't want to keep Buck in a kennel that long. Dog'd go plumb stir crazy. The money would come in handy for Christmas, 2 months away. She glanced into the shoebox at the tied sandwich bags of vitamins. Such planning. Still inside the wagon, Peaches said, "Sorry we're missing your mama. She always stays late on Monday to make out the food order." Delilah was dietitian for the county school district. She supervised student lunches for the 4 schools without a day of college training. "I told you, Papa, he can work Buck if he'd like, but I'd also appreciate you giving him a little exercise every day. Just let him get back in that cornfield and flush a few birds," said Uncle Jack. Quail and rabbit hopped around out there. "Okay," Sam promised. Most of their 230 acres were in corn, the stripped stalks now in Halloween garb to await plowing under in the spring. Sam's father, Jack's younger brother, leased the planting acres to a neighbor farmer west of the property, which was a quarter mile off the north-south federal highway. Chief Warrant Bosun Stuart Sanders presently had duty at the Coast Guard base on Craney Island, up in Hampton Roads across from Norfolk. Most nights he commuted back to the farm. Others, he stayed on the base, depending on his duty watch. Sam hadn't been around Buck too much, but she knew he was a highly trained animal. Uncle Jack and Aunt Peaches, childless by choice, worshipped him. Peaches called him Bucky and kissed him on the mouth. "But just don't put him in with those noisy mongrels," Jack said, nodding toward the hunt pens. "I promise. He'll stay in the barn tied up till I get home from school." "In the house, please, Samantha," said Aunt Peaches. "He won't destroy anything, never has." Sam said, "Okay, in the house," knowing her papa would never allow it. Uncle Jack opened the left-hand rear door, and Buck jumped out. Jack said, "Sit, Buck. You remember Samantha, don't you?" Oh, my, thought Sam. Buck looked up at his master with those intense yellow eyes as if to say plainly, "Why, yes, I do." Buck plainly adored Uncle Jack. Sam took a deep breath. "Well, he's all yours, Sam, and off we go to Gay Paris," said Uncle Jack. He was forever the rotary Kiwanis salesman type, backslapper supreme. "After Paris, on to Athens and a Mediterranean cruise with a 2-week African safari as the topper." He kissed Sam's cheek, then bent over to pat Buck's head. And Peaches had gotten out of the car and knelt down to hug and kiss the Baron. "We are sure going to miss you, Bucky," she said. As they returned to the car, Sam said, "You all have a load of fun." She felt another stab of envy. Someone was going somewhere, but it wasn't her. Buck sat obediently, but gazed at the Lesabre as it got back on the dirt road, horn tooting happily again. Uncle Jack and Aunt Peaches waved goodbye. Sam's hand waved back like a railroad crossing signal. A sudden look of emptiness was on her face. Times like these reminded her just how ridiculous it was to be stuck 14 miles from Currituck, the nearest town, one that had fewer than 5,000 people. Watch TV at night,
and all the programs were about people who lived in cities. None about people living on lonely roads like Chappanook. TV people lived in apartments or on streets with streetlights and grass lawns and neighbors. Sam sighed as the green wagon went east. As soon as it disappeared around the first bend, she sat down by her charge for a little conversation. "Now, Buck, for the next 6 weeks, you and I are going to be close, real close. I don't need any trouble. I've got enough of that already, so you've got to stick around, behave yourself, listen to me." Buck didn't seem to be paying any attention to her words, not that she expected him to. He was occupied with the new smells of the farm and the October fields. His nostrils dilated in audible sniffs. Then his head swerved to the right, and he took off in that direction, a gray streak. So much for training. Yelling at him to come back, Sam saw in the distance what he'd seen, a black bear coming out of their small apple orchard between the cornfields. It was heading back into the swamp. Baron von Buckner, probably not knowing that bears even existed, gave chase. He was barking, which only served to speed the Bruin along. Martin and Rick joined the racket, Martin in his finest baritone. Running with every ounce of strength 16 years on Earth had given her, Sam watched helplessly as the bear bounded into the Powhatan, CDX Buck right after it. Hearing the roof, roof, roof already beginning to fade, she shouted, "Buck, come back, damn it, come back!" And panicking, started to follow, then drew up, furious at what the dog had done. Tenny's had no place in the Powhatan, so she ran to the house for waders and a warm jacket. The temperature was dropping every hour. Brother to the Indians, who always apologized after a kill. Bears are wise and mystical. They live on after death as wind and rain and stars, Indians say. The wind is the breath of a dead bear. I reconstructed Henry's life. Born in the south part of the Powhatan, he'd weigh little more than 11 ounces, just a fraction of what human babies weigh. His sister in the same litter was an ounce lighter. Cubs mostly come in twos. Well, before their birth, Henry's mother had scooped out a den in dry, soft earth beneath a fallen tree, lining it with twigs and leaves. After feeding throughout the fall, she'd become semi-dormant in December, sleeping in anticipation of her cubs. Bears do not truly hibernate. They simply become inactive, breathing 4 or 5 times a minute. If disturbed, they awaken with a growl and often leave the den within seconds, angrily. For days, Henry trembled from the ordeal of passage into the world, eyes tightly closed, nursing whenever hungry, making a humming sound. Mother and cubs left the winter bed in mid-April, and their life was very secure throughout the summer and fall. Henry's mother was never more than 20 or 30 feet away. His time was spent wrestling with his sister, learning to feed himself and climb trees, or sleeping. When winter returned to the swamp, he weighed 72 pounds, and it was back to a new den and more dozing until spring. That April, able to survive without his mother, feeding himself on tender leaves, buds, and new spring grass, Henry responded to the mysterious ticking of his own lifespan clock, parting from his mother and sister, never to join them again. Looking much as he'd look for the rest of his life, eyes small, ears rounded, coat glossy black, snout brown, claws sharp, and jaws powerful, Henry was a fine specimen. By the time he was 6 years old and fully grown, he'd reached his maximum weight of over 300 pounds. From the moment we met, the one thing I positively knew about Henry was that he couldn't have cared less about my face. Animals judge humans
by smell and body language, not appearance. Powhatan Swamp, English 1, Charles Clute, Ohio State University. Up in her bedroom, Sam glanced at her 410 gauge shotgun. Her father had given it to her for her 12th birthday, but she had yet to shoot it, much to his dismay. It gathered dust in a corner of the room next to her frilly four-poster bed, another sore point. Modern furniture was what she wanted. On second thought, the gun was a bad idea. If Buck happened to tree the bear, she'd need a rope to drag him away. The dog, not the bear. Birdshot and bears were a bad mix anyway. Taking stairs two at a time, she ran to the work shed by the barn, cut a piece of laundry line, then headed out, not thinking to leave a note in the kitchen to say where she'd gone. Ever since she could remember, her mother had said, "Never go back in there alone, Samantha. Never." Up until Mr. Howell was murdered, she'd occasionally entered the swamp with her father on hunting trips, never enjoying them. Once she'd seen him kill a deer, bad dreams resulting. Or she'd gone in a little way with Steve or her mother on guard against snakes to pick berries for canning. Mid-December for mistletoe was another time, but never far into it, never alone. The last 4 years, since the Powhatan had become a national wildlife refuge, few people except biologists, geologists, and archaeologists had penetrated deep into it. Of course, poachers still hunted back in there, risking arrest. Facing the porch at about 50 yards, a broad tangle of brush and low trees and licks of brown water, the swamp sometimes looked ghostly when thin mist arose. Summers, when the breeze blew off it, there was a damp smell of rotten leaves in the air. Breeze carried sounds, too, birds and frogs and four-footed animal noises. Some nights, as a little girl in the four-poster, she'd covered her ears at the cries and croaks, the yap-yapping of the foxes, the blood-curdling shrieks of the bobcats. 3 times they'd lived in the farmhouse, when Bosun Sanders had duty in the Norfolk Portsmouth area. And she'd seen the Powhatan in winter, spring, summer, and fall. It had a different mood for each season, none of them too inviting, so far as she was concerned. Now, hearing Buck faintly in the distance, she waded across the ditch fronting the road and entered the refuge. "Always try to stay on hard ground. Keep out of the water as much as possible." That was her papa, swamper, hunter, fisherman, talking to Steve long ago, warning him. It made sense. There was enough hard ground on which to maneuver most of the time, except in the lake, random pools, man-made ditches, and creeklets. The water was seldom more than a foot deep, but hard ground was always safer. There were 9 trails along the banks of the ditches and sloughs, first used by lumber wagons 2 centuries ago, more recently used by lumber trucks. They were now barely passable in some places, overgrown with vines and weeds. Sam had been on only one of them long ago. Most worrisome were the peat pits. One type was the moss peat her papa used for litter and mulch. The other was fuel peat, with deposits as deep as 30 feet, used for heating in other countries. Both kinds were found in the Powhatan. Sometimes underground fires hollowed the deposits, leaving a thin black crust to cover huge holes that were often filled with water. Her grandpa and papa had fallen into them before, as had deer and bear and all kinds of other animals. The lucky ones, her papa and grandpa included, had crawled out. Feet pounding on, Sam hoped she'd be lucky this late afternoon. In addition to traces of the rough lumbering trails, there were remains of a narrow-gauge railroad, relic of timbering days. 4 years of growth were beginning to return the swamp to a state of semi-wilderness. No hunting or fishing was allowed, a law that did not sit well with Sam's papa and many others. Indian summer. Ripening time. Is the time for serious eating in the Powhatan. Named after Chief Powhatan, father of Pocahontas. Time for bears like Henry to store up fat to last through the winter, which is usually comparatively mild, nothing like the frigid weeks in northern forests. Yet I remember days when ice edged the ditches and ponds, the surface of Lake Nansemond, when snow softly mantled the swamp. So the animals and birds, responding to the season, ate from dawn to dark. Food is plentiful in autumn. Pawpaw and black gum and pokeberries, and the luscious wild grapes. Tupelo berries are choice, and acorns are thick under the oaks. 22 species of animal life walk and crawl and slither around the swamp. Shrews and moles thrive, as well as mice and muskrats. In addition to the bears, bobcats, river otters, mink, gray and red foxes, raccoons, weasels, and white-tailed deer all live there. The gray wolf once stalked the Powhatan, but hasn't been seen since Indian days. There are the usual noisy flocks of red-winged blackbirds and grackles and cowbirds and common crows, hundreds of thousands of robins, gray catbirds, and Carolina wrens singing gaily. I could hear the wheat of the towhee and talk, talk, talk of the working woodpecker. See pine siskins feeding on juniper cones. Overhead, night and day, fly tundra swans and Canadian geese, en route to wintering grounds in the south. Loons going that way, too, wail mournfully. Great ospreys occasionally let their passage be known with a harsh creak, 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 creak. The soaring turkey vultures stay home. They love the Powhatan. Though it sounds strange, sometimes I talked to the swamp, and sometimes it talked back in its own unique way. I know that many people say, ugh, at the mere mention of swamp, the reputation being more of beast than beauty. Yet it's probably the most misunderstood landscape of all. And those who do enter it and stand still for a while to listen and watch can often find a melancholy beauty, especially in autumn and early winter. I found that beauty through the eyes of Tom Telford, who was conducting the bear study in the Powhatan. With its rush-lined waterways and ponds encircled by the brown heads of cattails, its strips of forested high ground and acres of soggy marsh, the Powhatan is fortunately not for everyone. That's just fine for the kings of it, the black bears, white-tailed deer, and bobcats. Humans are incidental. Powhatan Swamp, English 1, Charles Clute, Ohio State University. Pushing through bramble, thorns tore at her jeans and leather jacket. Thankful a pair of gloves had been in the pockets, Sam could just hear Buck. She guessed he was still on the chase, the bear not treed as yet. They're headed for the lake, she thought. Most of the bears lived on the south side of it, according to her papa. Every few hundred yards, she stopped to listen. The first hard frost had brought shades of brown. The deeper she pushed, the more she was encased in tangles of cinnamon and cocoa and bronze. Some reached out for her. There were specific bear paths throughout the swamp. Her grandpa had described them, narrow tunnels about 3 feet high through the thick brush, not big enough for deer or man, but a bear could easily scramble through them. So could a dog like Buck. But it wasn't a wise route. The bear could decide to make a stand in the tunnels. Goodbye, Buck. Rarely were the bears seen by human eyes. She'd seen no more than a half dozen. Yet when the corn was roasting size and ripened, or at apple time, such as now, they ventured out for banquets. They also raided peanut fields and beehives, Sam knew. On she ran, sliding, stumbling. Mixed in with the tough and grasping briar shrubs, some patches so thick she couldn't see daylight on the other side, were trees. Bald cypress and junipers, the local name for cedars. Tupelo gum, red maple and sweet bay, in glorious fall colors. In other parts of the swamp were loblolly pine and white oak, occasionally draped with Spanish moss. Plenty of trunks for any bear to climb. Hundreds of thousands of trees had been cut down when the lumber company owned the swamp, but thousands more had burned in lightning fires that sent brown-black coils of smoke out over the Atlantic 40 miles away. Sometimes the peat deposits burned and smoldered for months. The brief, savage summer storms hit the Powhatan every so often. Lightning turned it calcium white. Thunder rumbled across it as if a giant was waving huge sheets of tin. The deafening thunder and lightning attacks scared the wits out of animal and man alike, but Sam loved the noisy storms. She stopped again, listened, and shook her head in dismay. How had she gotten into this? Uncle Jack and Aunt Peaches had often bragged about how smart Buck was. Well, he sure didn't use his dog brains this day. Sam plunged on. Lake Nansemond was in the center of the swamp. It provided water down the feeder ditch for the George Washington Canal, which formed the lake's eastern border. Nansemond was about 5.5 miles from home, and Sam hoped both the bear and Buck would stop long before they came to the lake. She didn't care to run all the way out there. It wasn't too big, maybe 3,000 acres, 2 miles, across at the widest, but like the rest of the swamp, a little spooky, with water the color of ox blood from tree root acids. When she was a little girl, her father brought her up the feeder ditch to fish for bream and crappie. She didn't enjoy those trips either, but she never told him that. Sam pulled up, listening again. Buck still yapped, maybe a mile ahead, maybe more. Sound carried a long way in the eerie stillness. A quiet broken only now and then by bird cries. She looked up at the slate-colored sky, then down at her watch. 4:30. A half hour or less till complete darkness. She should have brought a flashlight. Her feet had begun to blister, she knew. She'd quickly put on sweat socks before changing into the waders, but rubber boots weren't built for running. She'd soon have to stop. After the government took over the Powhatan, someone on the refuge staff had posted a map of the swamp. Sam had seen it several times. With twilight approaching, she thought she paralleled trail number 6. The trails were numbered westward from the canal. And somewhere off 6, perhaps not far ahead, was the sand suck, as old-timers called it, a big patch of quicksand, a landmark. She'd heard of it all her life from her grandpa, her papa, and others, but she'd never seen it. After the Powhatan became government property, the Fish and Wildlife Service ringed its 5 acres with barbed wire, posting big red and white signs that said, "Danger, do not enter." So far as Sam was concerned, the sand suck had always been a creepy place. But now she hoped she'd see those warning signs so she could get her bearings. The sand suck was there when George Washington surveyed the canal. There when the Civil War was fought. It might have been there 2,000 years ago before Christ was born. Geologists haven't been able to do more than guess at its true age. I saw it a half dozen times or more. Deep within its slippery, sandy depths are bones of all sorts of mammals unfortunate enough to step on its tricky surface or doomed by being tossed into it. Probably Indians and slaves and deserting Confederate soldiers, bootleggers and unlucky hunters. Certainly there are bones of wild cattle and wild hogs and bears and dogs and deer, almost every creature that ever inhabited the Powhatan. Without doubt there are gray wolf and panther remains down there. Perhaps deeper down, where ice once slid, are skeletons of ancient giant reptiles. In addition to bones, there are the remains of modern civilization, pots and pans and stoves, maybe even whiskey stills tossed in by revenue agents. Perhaps an old car or two. Trash of all kinds. I once threw a tire in. It disappeared with a gurgle. Powhatan Swamp, English 1, Charles Clute, Ohio State University. Twilight. Two distinct shots split the somber stillness, the reverberations finally dying in the dense cushion of brush and trees. Sam heard them, but the immediate noise of several turkey vultures taking to the air ahead of her almost drowned out the faint echoes. Paying little attention to the shots, Sam looked again at her watch, 4:45. Roughly 15 minutes until night would lock her in. 15 minutes to find Buck and tie that length of laundry line around his idiot neck. Then what? By now she thought she'd covered about 2.5 miles, almost half the distance to the lake. Sam began to realize the predicament she was in. It was impossible to move safely in the Powhatan after dark without a light. Even if she did find the Weimaraner, they'd have to spend the night. Slowing to a walk, she remembered that Grandpa Sanders told her about a few nights he'd stayed in the swamp as a boy, muskrat trapping. He said to find a fire-hollowed stump, make sure there weren't any snakes or bats in it, scoop out any ants and bugs if it was summer, then curl up inside. Even though she could still hear the distant echoes of barks ahead in the remaining light, Sam began to search for shelter. Finally, she saw a charred gum, about 6 feet of it above the surface, big bell-like trunk standing in the still water, likely hit by lightning years ago. Reaching down inside it, digging out handfuls of rotten wood and char, she climbed in. Darkness enclosed the Powhatan a few minutes later. After a while, the barking ceased, and Sam wondered if Buck had tired of the chase or if the bear had killed him. Compressed in the stump, long legs folded, Sam knew she'd be painfully stiff and sore long before dawn, but it was better than sliding and stumbling blindly in marsh water. Night noises had risen around her. They weren't exactly a soothing symphony. Squeaks and clicks and sawing and flapping, night birds called and cawed and coughed. The barred owl hooted. Had it been summer, the hollow rasp of bullfrogs would be deafening. Thank the Lord it wasn't summer when the snakes were out and about. Sam had been terrified of them ever since her brother put a corn snake in her bed, the only time she'd ever hit him, right in the mouth. Inside her narrow haven, which smelled of ancient fire, she could see the evening bats that swooped and twirled around the gray treetops. Though a farm girl, Sam had never laid claim to bravery. Grandpa Sanders, who died 3 years ago, had told Sam and Steve about the people who'd lived there, the prehistorics and the Powhatan Indians, the juniper shingle cutters who had come before the Revolutionary War, the whole community of runaway slaves, men, women, and children, who had hid back there, the hunters and trappers who had disappeared in the brush and muck. Between tobacco spits, he told them about hundreds, maybe thousands, who had died in the Powhatan. The stories reminded Sam of shot-in-the-chest Alvin Howell. He still came back in dreams now and then, bringing midnight screams with him. Sam's blistered feet had begun to send darting pain up her legs. She was tempted to take the waders off, but decided to wait till morning. Any protection from the cold was essential. If they lived in Portsmouth or Norfolk, where there were people and lights and malls, none of this would have happened. Whenever her father was transferred to duty away from the farm, she rejoiced. In another year, when she finished high school, she'd transfer herself out of Albemarle County, North Carolina. Goodbye cornfields, swamp, and old farmhouse, four-poster bed. She hated where she lived, hated that creaky house. 120 years old, she wanted a new one. Stranded was what she felt, with only the bicycle to take her anywhere, unless her mother or father were home. Then she could borrow the pickup or the Bronco to go on babysitting jobs. During school months, she worked Saturdays and Sundays at the Dairy Queen in Currituck, filling soft ice cream cones and not making enough to buy her own car, barely enough to pay her phone bill. At least she had her own phone. The phone was her lifeline to the outside world. "Trouble with you, Samantha, is you're always feeling sorry for yourself," her mother had said more than once. Sam had silently agreed. "Am sorry. Was sorry. Will remain sorry for good reason." She didn't resent her mother saying that. It was the honest truth. Listening to all the cackling and jabbering, flapping and croaking, Sam wondered again what had happened to Buck. She knew her mother and father would be worried about both of them. She finally slept a while, then awakened, colder than before.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.